Hi friends, today we are going to do a common topic known as sports training, which is important for both grade 10th and 12th. What does sports training basically means? Sports training is nothing but a scheduled training of a physical activity, a programmed trained activity in physical education as well as sports. Sports training is nothing but an organized or a programmed training. In simple words, it's like it's a special process of preparation of sports based scientific principles aimed at improving and maintaining higher performance. Sports training is also used to enhance the capacity of a player in different sports activity. It is a particular type of training designed to improve fitness, ability to perform at a higher level in various sports. If you ask me what is the aim of sports training, the aim of sports training is to achieve maximum individual or team efficiency in a selected sports discipline, limited by rules, or reaching maximum efficiency in any activity which is not possible over a day. It is nothing but a format of practicing into a time limited or a discipline schedule. So if you ask me what is a difference between a physical training and a sports training, physical training is limited to enhance physical fitness, and sports training is basically to improve a sports performance in a particular sport. Physical fitness is a vast component. It's like physical fitness can be helpful for all the sports, but sports training of a particular sports cannot be helpful for everyone. For example, a sports training of an athlete may not be similar to a cricketer, to a swimmer, or anybody else. Now, if we see the types of sports training, there are types of sports training. The major two types of sports training which includes aerobic, anaerobic, flexibility and strength training. These are the types of training. Students mostly get confused in methods of sports training and types of sports training. So types of sports training are mostly aerobic, anaerobic, flexibility, flexibility. And strengthening. These are the types of sports. Now, one of the most important aspect between types of sports training and methods of sports training is the types. Types means the various types on which factor is the sports training done, and methods means the technique of various sports trainings. Such as, if you ask me about methods, training methods can be different. It's like slow training, fast training, continuous training. These are the methods of training. It's like you can do an interval training. It's like you train for some time and then you take a break. Continuous training means once you start training, you continue all sets and then stop. Slow training, it's like you stand at a particular place and do a training. Fast training, it's like you do a continuous fasting. It's like from one exercise you go to the other, to the third, to fourth and fifth. So please note down the methods. Methods of training, as I said. It's like the slow training, or you can say stationary training, then fast training, then continuous. Continuous training, and you can call it as interval training. Then comes one of the most important aspects, as compared to the board pattern, is the principle. The terminology, the principles of sports training. Students, you have to understand this is one of the most important aspects of a sports training, which defines the terminology, or it's the baseline, it's the carbon copy of each sports training, because the sports training is completely dependent on the principles of sports training. It's like on what basis you are training an athlete or you are training a sportsman, whether it's a beginner, intermediate or an elite. The training, the principles of training changes according to the person, according to the athlete, according to the atmospheric conditions, according to the facilities available, according to the geographical location, according to the physical structure of the athlete, according to the age, according to the area, or according to the area of specialization of athlete, whether it's a beginner, whether it's an intermediate, or whether it's an elite athlete playing at various levels, areas of specialization. For example, if it's a football player, what area does he play? If it's a basketball player, at what position he is playing? If he or she is an athlete, what kind of activity he is doing? Or a swimmer, what kind of stroke is doing? Because the training changes from every single aspect of the athlete. Because if all these things are not considered, you cannot attain a highest level of performance from an athlete. So all these aspects are necessary to understand regarding sports training. There are principles of sports training. Now, What do you mean by principles of sports training? Training means engaging in an activity to improve performance or fitness. This is best accomplished by understanding general sports training principles. And the principles of sports training are, one is overload. We will come to the specific explanation of all this later on. First, we'll try and understand the whole concept of sports training, its method, principles, and type. And then we will come to the aspect of individual description of principles of sports training, which is an important chapter. According to the board specification, sports training comes for almost like 25 to 30%. Of the complete marks of 50 marks paper at section A. So it is one of the most important chapter because it asks about 2 to 3 questions on principles of sports training. So students, please be very careful when you are writing it. You have to understand the difference between principle, methods, and types of sports training. Next comes the progression, the principle of progression of load. Or you can only write principle of progression and then you explain the part of what do you mean by progression. Progression means progression of the load. Load means the capacity of training taken by an athlete. Then comes the principle of individuality. The principle of individuality or individualization. It means that training depends or changes from individual to individual. Next come specificity. Specificity. Then comes reversibility. One of the most important aspects. Most of the time, training might bring a reverse or a negative effect on the individual, on his performance or his physical fitness. These are the 5 principles, important principles of sports training. Principle of overload, principle of progression, principle of individuality, or principle of specificity, principle of reversibility. Next, one of the most important component in sports training is called the periodization. Periodization. What is periodization? Periodization is nothing else but to time the complete training it's like moving the whole training into a particular plan. It's just like periodization. It is the systematic planning. Please write down. It is the systematic planning of athlete or physical training. The aim is to reach the best possible performance in the most important competition of the year. Periodization means it is a time-bound process of sports training. Mostly periodization of sports is limited to the complete season or a complete year of every sportsman. That's the only reason it says as the competition of the year. It involves progressive cycling of various aspects of training program during a specific period. Please write it down. I will also write it for you. Periodization is the systematic planning of athlete of athletic or physical training. Physical training. The aim is to reach the best possible. I hope you all are jotting down the important points. I hope you have written the meaning of sports training. The aim is to reach the best possible performance in the most important year of competition. Periodization is nothing but the cycle or the time bound period of how the training is going to go all about. It is basically divided into four important parts. It's like the pre-competition period, the competition period, the transition period. And after the transition period, again, the preparatory period. So these four aspects can be adjusted into a training calendar according to the area of specialization of that particular athlete. For example, preparatory period. For example, if the season or if the competition year is getting completed by December, so all these four phases are equally divided or divided as per the requirement or the training schedule or the sports calendar of that individual athlete. And then it is completely covered across the whole year. If we take 3-3 months of each phase, so the first phase is the preparatory phase. The second phase is the pre-competition phase. The third phase is the competition phase. The fourth phase is the transitional phase. After the transitional phase, again the cycle of periodization starts from the next competition year, and it is on. Most of the time, it is termed as a terminology as the micro cycle of periodization or the macro cycle of periodization. Micro cycle of periodization means the small change of phase into a particular phase, and macro means a change of phase across the whole competition year. I hope you all are understanding it. Let's continue and complete the periodization part. It involves progressive cycling of various aspects of a training program during a specific period. When I say during a specific period, it's like in whole year, the preparatory period might be shorter. The pre-competition period might be little bigger, the competition period again might be shorter, and the transition period, depending upon the number of competition available in a year, the transition period might quite be little bigger as compared to all the other phases. Let's save this particular component so that it will be useful for your friends. Please keep on taking screenshots of this particular chapters, which will be helpful for you. So I'm deleting this particular component and let's move towards our main component. First, we have written types of training. Now we are going to focus on types of sports training. Again, please note, the types of training changes according to the individual's requirement. So you have to understand first what is the requirement of the athlete or of the sportsman. What are its requirements? And according to the requirement, the types of training changes. They are aerobic, anaerobic, flexibility and strength training. There are few more trainings which comes into this category. Please note it down. Low intensity, medium intensity, high intensity. Athletic, circuit, concurrent, and conducive. Training. These are the types of training. Some of these training might not be there into your textbook. These are the kind of sports training which have been used on the athletes, such as resistance training, which again is not mentioned in your textbook. Resistance means you create a barrier or a degree of difficulty into the training module. For example, if an 100 meter runner runs very easily on the turf, you take him to the sand or into the water and make him do the running kind of movement. It is called as the resistance training. The low intensity training means the specific kind of training which is used on the beginners. It's like for a beginner, you don't start immediately with like 5 sprint repetition or 5 50 meter repetition or 6 or 10 repetitions of 50 meter running. you start slow and gradually with an athlete. First, you give him one or two repetitions of 50 meter sprinting and the other training. For medium intensity, it's like you keep on increasing the intensity, the repetitions of the training on that particular athlete. High intensity is used specifically for elite. You change the modulation of the training intensity, the effect. Intensity means the effect or the load, the pressure, the volume of pressure. Intensity can be mentioned as volume of pressure put on the athlete while doing a training. When I say high intensity, you either make the 100 meter sprinter do squats, jump squat, lunges with dumbbells, and then make him run 50 meters with his full capacity. That is called the high intensity training, which is used for the higher athletes. Then comes the fartlek training. What does fartlek training means? Fartlek training is nothing but a name. Fartlek means speed play. It's like a speed training. Came after the Swedish trainer who named this particular speed training as the fartlek training. It is a continuous training with intervals. Fartlek runs are very simple for long distance run. Fartlek is simply designed as a period of fast running intermixed with period of slow running. For example, if you are running a 400 meter track, it's like on the curve you jog, and on the straights you start sprinting for faster. If you are training, if you are training on a straight road, it's like for 30 strides you sprint and then you jog. Again, you stride out for run faster for some distance and then again jog down. This is called a fartlek training. What can be a better example of fartlek training? It's like run hard up to a hill to the crest, jog across the walks, jog and then walk. Accelerate when you are coming downhill. When you are climbing up a hill or an incline, you jog slowly when you're climbing up and you jog with full intensity when you're coming down. Then you can run for 6 minutes, then jog, then 5 minutes, then jog, then 4 minutes, 3 minutes, 2 minutes. These are various examples where you do a high intensity training modulated with the help of low intensity training. This is the fartlek training. It is basically done to increase the speed of the athlete. Then comes the circuit training. Circuit training is nothing but it's like various two or three exercises are mixed together to done one particular training. Circuit training is a form of body conditioning or a resistance training using high intensity aerobic. It targets strength building and muscular endurance. And circuit is a completion of a prescribed exercise in a time-bound module. Now, what can be a better example of circuit training? It's like if you are doing an upper body, you do push-ups, then you do a pull-ups, then if you have a medicine ball, you do a medicine ball press, a bench lift, a bench press, and then an incline bench. If you are doing a core or a trunk training, it's like you do sit-ups, then you do crunches, and then back again to a pull-up with leg raise. It's like you do 2 to 3 trainings of one particular group of muscles in a continuous format. That is known as the circuit training. Then the next is the resistance training. Resistance training is nothing but creating a barrier or an obstruction for a smooth flow of training. Resistance training is a form of exercise that improves muscular strength and endurance. During a resistance training workout, you move your limbs against the resistance provided by your body weight, gravity. For example, if you are a 50 meter athlete running or sprinting forward, you will be pulled by a stretch band or a parachute will be put up, which will slow down your speed. You try to run against the wind and the resistance will pull you back. You try your full strength to move forward and the resistance will bring you backward. The parachute which is pulling you back is nothing but running against the wind. The wind which is flowing and pushing you or making your movement difficult is the resistance used for that particular training. That is called the resistance training. Then comes the concurrent training. Concurrent training are in today's training formats are not much use. It's a kind of training which complements with the simple form of exercise according to the modulation which are used for specifically development of muscles. It's like strength building exercises and the growth of muscle. We call as the hypertrophy of muscles, means the size of the muscle increases with the help of concurrent training. Concurrent training is nothing but it is the simultaneous physical preparation of two or more exercise. Common combinations of these exercise includes strength and power, or the hypertrophy, the growth of muscle is being kept into focus. At the same time, the strength building, or sometimes it is power and endurance. These are the combinations which are used during the concurrent training. Then it's like the next form of training known as the conducive training. Conducive training is specifically done with your own body weight. These particular trainings are being advanced into various kind of other trainings. It's like CrossFit has come across, which is nothing but a kind of strength training or a speed training. Conditional training means it's like if you are going to go at a place where the geographical conditions are quite very freezing cold or colder, you create an atmosphere or you practice at an place or an indoor facility where the temperature is very cold, or if the temperature is going to be dry and quite sunny or hot, the atmosphere is being created to practice into a hot temperature. It's like if you are going to play at a place where there is a cold climate, you specifically practice in colder mornings. If the temperature is going to be very hot and sunny, you practice in the afternoon time. These are called conducive training. Conducive training means training according to the particular geographical, preparing your body according to a particular geographical locations where you are going to play that particular sports. All these things are most important because on these various training modules, the performance of an athlete is completely dependent. That's the only reason sports training should be done after a proper study of an athlete. As I said at the beginning of the lecture, there are certain conditions, not conditions, it's like there are certain pointers on which the sports training is developed, or you can also write the factors affecting sports training, or you can also write factors on which sports training of an athlete or sports is decided. It depends on the gender, It depends on the area of specialization. It also depends on the geographical condition physical structure climatic conditions surrounding or you can say equipments or facilities available. And the last one, the economic level of the athlete. Age can also be the factor. At the same time, level of athlete, whether the athlete is a beginner, intermediate, or an elite. Right athlete. These are certain factors on which this sports training is completely dependent. The only thing you all have to remember at class 10 and class 12 is what do you mean by sports training, which is a most likely question. The types of sports training, which I have just discussed now. The methods of sports training and these principles of sports training. At the same time, you should also be aware on factors on which a sports training depends. All these factors helps into a stronger performance of an athlete. So please note, all these factors helps to enhance the performance of any athlete. This is how sports training work for the development of each and every athlete. So please go through all the information which I have posted. I hope you are taking the screenshots also. So if you have not taken a screenshot of this particular information, please take the screenshot of this particular information very quickly. At the same time, I will also save the necessary information. Thank you so much for listening to me very patiently, and we will come back on the next module tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Thank you.